ACE, the Academic Center for Entrepreneurship, ACE here at Bristol Community College, has been with us for a number of years, the 9th annual awards banquet. This is a program, and April, I'm sure, will speak about it a little bit more in depth. This is a program which gives students the opportunity to develop their own business ideas, develop the business plan to go out either while they're at BCC or after they leave BCC, to go out and really take their dreams, make it a reality in the business world. So it's one of our academic programs that we're very, very proud of here at BCC. So without further ado, I just want to introduce now the director of ACE, Professor April Lynch.
Hello, everyone. Good evening. I'd like to thank you all for coming. I see a lot of familiar faces tonight and probably a lot of new faces, too, so we appreciate having you here. I'm really excited tonight about our guest speaker. Because let me tell you a little backstory about why I'm so excited. I believe that Johnny Cupcakes encompasses the entrepreneurial spirit. He had started 16 businesses by the time he was 16 years old. And so I remember from my branding days in Boston years ago, reading an article about him. And I had said to my business partner at the time, you know, look at this. Here's a guy who's starting a t-shirt business and he's trying to do it as a bakery. And I remember being intrigued from the brand from that very moment, and I followed his brand through. And so at the time, I remember people in our industry thinking he was crazy. Boy, were they wrong. Let me tell you a little bit about our speaker. He began what's now become Johnny Cupcakes from the trunk of his car at age 19. His vision and perseverance allowed him to build a multi-million dollar brand that's recognized the world over. He's been named America's number one entrepreneur by Business Week, one of the top innovative people by the Boston Globe, and he's also been recognized 4 years in a row by Inc. 500 as innovative people, as one of the fastest growing independent companies. He's been featured on mediums such as MTV, NPR, Forbes, and Wired, to name just a few. Please join me tonight in welcoming Johnny Earl, AKA Johnny Cupcakes.
Hello, everybody. Who's Portuguese? Everybody, me too. I meet a new cousin every time I come here. So my name is Johnny Cupcakes. Cupcakes is not my real last name, but sometimes I pretend it is. And I tell people that it's pronounced Cupcakes and that it's Portuguese. A little bit about myself. I like Wu-Tang Clan. I like banh mi sandwiches. I love Mario Kart 64, Aladdin the video game. I love to floss my teeth all the time. And Home Alone is one of my favorite movies. However, the people who now live here do not love trespassers, so I was only able to take 133 photos with my fake tarantula and talk boy before getting kicked off the property. What I don't love is traffic, and growing up in Hull, Massachusetts, I would witness my parents spend so much time waiting in traffic to commute and to get to work, and they didn't get to raise my little sister and I as much as we'd like. So at a young age, I was really inspired to someday figure out a way that I can work for myself so that I could spend more time with the people that I love. This is me when I was younger. Not much has changed. I still have all of those toys, and I can still fit into those clothes. There's me pretending to eat my little sister when she was born. There's my dad's award-winning mustache. My parents didn't have too much money growing up, so my mom would always attempt at cutting my own hair with kitchen scissors. So these are some of the haircuts that I got. Even though I had these weird haircuts, my mom taught me that it's what's inside that counts. So even though I rolled out of bed, looked like a weirdo, when I would go to school, I was very acceptant of others, and I was very curious about other people's lives. So I was always friends with the troublemakers, with the athletic kids, with the nerds, and it was great. Just being acceptant of other people really helps open up your network, and it's just a good thing to do. There's my little sister. She's my best friend. That's Lindsay. She's my best friend. By being an entrepreneur, I now get to see my sister every single day, and we work together, which is a true, true blessing. So I like to say, do more of what makes you happy. It's unfortunate that sometimes it takes a near-death experience for us to realize how valuable our happiness and our time really is. If you can figure out that earlier on and make a few shift a few things around in your life to make those changes, it's really up to you to make those changes and take that initiative. I was determined. I started 16 businesses before I was 16 years old, trying to figure out a way to work for myself so that I could spend more time with the people that I love. I started with lemonade stands. I graduated to having yard sales when my family was not home. Around Halloween, I'd set up haunted houses in my friend Brian's backyard. We'd charge people $1 a ticket. This was going great, but it started to look a little sketchy, so we stopped. I made a small investment in a snow shovel. I live in Massachusetts. Why not shovel snow? Could have gone sledding a lot more with my friends, but I realized I need to make time for myself if I want to make a little bit of extra money to get just a little bit more ahead, so that's what I did. If I could shovel 5 driveways and make $20 each, I could make $100 cash in a day. And by me barely being able to push this shovel, it worked out to my advantage because people felt bad for me, so they gave me extra money. Summertime rolled around, so did I. I'd go up and down Nantasket Beach with my bony adolescent limbs dragging this cooler filled with drinks that I would illegally sell. I realized at a young age I could get a 12-pack of Coca-Cola for a significantly discounted price, and I would resell those drinks. This was going great. At some point, I got into magic, and this is when everything changed. I realized that I could do something that makes me happy and that makes other people happy, and I could figure out a way to get paid for this, which seemed like magic in itself. I started doing magic at birthday parties. I would charge $20 a half an hour, which sounds like a lot, but I really only knew a half hour's worth of magic, so I never made more than $20. But this was going great. I was doing magic shows left and right, and I was infatuated with the audience and figuring out ways to create a fun experience for other people. My mother even put an ad in the local newspaper, and looking back on it, I realized two things. She gave me a scrapbook recently, and I'm reading this thing, and if you look really closely, you'll also realize that, one, my mother would drop me off at strangers' houses to perform magic when I was 8 years old. I'm like, Mom, I could have really disappeared. And the second thing is, you know, I'm not 8 years old anymore, so if I put this ad in the newspaper, it definitely looks a little sketchy, especially the last couple sentences. So that is that. So I had a hard time learning. I was diagnosed with multiple learning disabilities. I never took any drugs for it. I didn't look at it as a disability. I looked at it as a superpower, because I knew right away what I did not like, which was all of my homework. But when I did find one thing that I was passionate about, I would focus and I would almost obsess over it, which really felt like a superpower. And I would block out everything around me, whether that would be doing magic tricks or selling drinks on the beach, whatever it was, I would really obsess over it and put 110% into it. And just because I had a hard time focusing, it actually worked out better because I knew what I did not want to do. And sometimes it takes people a lifetime to figure out what they're passionate about or dispassionate about. So although I had a hard time learning, I didn't take any drugs for it. My parents put me into a charter school where I could learn in smaller classrooms, and that really helped things, really helped me out. And I took, you know, different testing. I had a little bit longer time to take those tests. I started drinking tea. I slowly stopped watching television, listened to classical music, figured out little ways to help me better focus. I still had terrible grades. It did not help. And it also didn't help me focus the fact that I was doing magic tricks during class all the time. So I went to school. It was still the best thing that happened to me. I went to the South Shore Charter School. This is me when I was younger. I used to want to be a gangster, but things changed, and not anymore. So I still listen to gangster rap music, but I just dress a little differently. I realized that the charter school did not have a yearbook. Since this was a startup charter school, I decided to take my personal scrapbook and turn it into the school's very first yearbook. So what I did was I went around and I took pre-orders. I was selling something that didn't even exist yet. And by me making time for it, leaving my comfort zone, and making friends with people that I normally didn't talk to, it really helped me sell these yearbooks. So by the time I had to go pay for them, I was using other people's money, and I was able to take a very calculated risk. So if you ever have any ideas for a business you want to start, taking pre-orders is a great idea, a great way to promote yourself and to test out the waters. This went so well that the next year, the school decided to make their own yearbook, and I was out of a job. So since I was a class clown and my dad was always a jokester, anytime my friends would sleep over as a kid, my dad would always take our cat and put it inside of his shirt so he would have a cat head in his body. So all of my dad's shirts have like claw marks inside of it from the cat trying to escape so that my dad would be cat dad. But anyways, that's where I got my sense of humor from. I decided to start selling pranks. I used to go to this one joke shop all the time, and the owner sat down with me and he said, "Listen, kid, I appreciate your business, but how would you like it if I told you you could get 144 whoopee cushions for the price of 4 retail whoopee cushions?" I was like, whoa, that's a lot of whoopee cushions. I don't know what I'm gonna do with them all, but that's a really good deal. So I went home that day with 2 catalogs, one from Oriental Trading Company and the other one from Rhode Island Novelty. So I started ordering pranks at bulk discounts. I realized that if I take a financial risk up front and buy things in bulk, I could get a really good deal and make a really good profit. So the next day I went to school, the next week I went to school, I continued pranking people like I normally would, except this time I could say, "That could be yours for a small price of $4.99. And instead of people giving me money, most people would give me the middle finger because I embarrassed them in front of the whole class and everyone thought they crapped their pants when the whoopee cushion went off. I still sold some of these. I made my money back, but I still had over 100 whoopee cushions left. So for the next couple of years, everyone in my family got a whoopee cushion for their birthday, for Valentine's Day, for Easter, for Christmas. And then I came up with a really cool idea. At lunchtime, I would take my leftover whoopee cushions and I would trade them with other people for their snacks. I would then take those snacks and resell them to other people. All of a sudden, I got rid of all of my whoopee cushions, got new products, which was food, and everyone loves food, and then I sold all of those, and I had all this extra money. Now, whether you work for yourself or for another company, it's often attractive when you start making money to buy some new shoes, to buy a new briefcase or bag, or to get your car fixed. But in the early stages, more than anything, it's so important to reinvest that money back into yourself, whether it's your business card, your resume, your website, or just saving up a little bit. I was reinvesting my money back into pranks, itching powder, fart spray, stink bomb, switchblade combs, everything that I should not have been selling in school, I was buying and selling in school. Itching powder was a big seller until someone had an allergic reaction and had to get rushed to the emergency room. Their back was covered with hives and they were allergic to the ingredients in the itching powder. This isn't really their back. I got this off a Google image search. At first I typed in rash, and then I was like, oh no, and then I typed in back rash. So there we go. So I got in trouble, almost got expelled, but I got suspended. I was like, sweet, school vacation, went home. There's no good cartoons on TV, just depressing cash for gold commercials. And that diamond jewelry exchange where they all wave in opposite ways at the end. I don't know why, but that commercial really hurts my feelings. But I just wanted to go back to school, and I had to figure out something else to sell. Now, since most of my friends were selling drugs at the time, I decided to go down a different route, and I decided to sell candy. Now that I'm introduced to the whole world of wholesale, I know that I could get anything in the world at inexpensive prices as long as I take that initial risk up front and as long as I make time to work. It's easy. The more you put into work, the more you're going to get back, and that's how it works. There's no shortcuts. So that's what I was doing. Even though there was a school store, I had all the good stuff. I had M&M's, Swedish Fish, Sour Patch Kids. I would come home every day with a backpack full of cash. This was great. Some days were amazing. If I could sell 100 packs of candy 2 times a day, I went to a very small school, if I sold them at $1 each, that's $200 a day times 5 days a week, that's $1,000 cash a week. This did not happen all the time. This rarely happened because I didn't have my license yet, and because the school realized how much money I was making, so they decided to stop me because the school store donates money to school functions, and I was donating money to whoopee cushions and not having to get a real job. So I had to stop doing that. Entrepreneurship was not as wasn't as much of a thing in school as it is now, and I had to come up with something else to do. But even my drug dealer friends at the time were looking at me saying, "How much money did you make? That's crazy." And I said, "Guys, you actually gave me most of that money when you had the munchies every morning. You bought most of the snacks from me." So this was incredible. You know, they forgot by the time a couple hours passed, and that's what happens to your brain cells, I guess. But seriously, most of the kids I grew up with are either dead or in jail, mostly from heroin. It's unfortunate. I think it's, I don't know what it is. Well, it's, I could go on and on about it, but the prescription drugs that are legal take you down this dark alley. And when you live in a cold state of Massachusetts and you're in a beach town and there's nothing to do, some people unfortunately resort to one thing that leads to another. And I've seen too many people that I know pass away. So I kept positive. I went down a different route, and I've never really partied before. I've actually never had a sip of beer in my life. I've never been drunk before, and I've never tried any drugs. I listen to songs about drugs every day. I love rap music, but it was never for me. And I'll get into that in a little bit on why. But one of the requirements to graduate from the South Shore Charter School was to get an internship, and I didn't realize how valuable an internship could be. I'm flipping through a phone book trying to figure out what I'm passionate about. There's a construction company. I'm not really built for that. There's a plumbing company. I love the Mario Brothers, but I didn't want to be a plumber just yet. And then I found a place that prints t-shirts. I wanted to learn how to make clothes. I thought this would be pretty cool. Sometimes you could get a paid internship, but the best part about an internship is the experience that you get. And no matter how long you go to school for, the first thing people ask you when you go to get a job is how much real life experience you have. If you can have both, that's even better. But you have to get that real life experience. And what's best about internships, you learn right away what you want to do for the rest of your life or what you do not want to do for the rest of your life, which is just as valuable because it could save you a lot of time, money, and stress. This was going great. I didn't think of the Johnny Cupcakes t-shirt brand just yet, but anytime a t-shirt came out of that dryer, it was like an idea machine, and it really inspired me to just think about things in a different way. So you're never too young and you're never too old to intern, to volunteer, to job shadow. Even if you want to get into the apparel industry, I know there's a lot of sneaker companies in Massachusetts. You can email someone from Reebok or New Balance or Converse and say, hey, you know, I'd love to go out for coffee for 15 minutes and pick your brain. You might want to email 100 different people, and maybe one person will reply back. But that one person and that 15 minutes that they give you could change the way you think and could give you new opportunities that could alter the future of your life. You just have to make time for it. So learning hands-on is key, especially for me. So those internships were crucial for me finding out what I was passionate about. I was focusing now, playing later. I still had other businesses. I DJed with real records, no laptops. I had glow sticks that I sold on the beach around 4th of July. I even sold Tupperware at one point, which was pretty cool because I was the only guy that was doing this. But at one point, it became a little creepy. I still love Tupperware. I still have all of my Tupperware. I just do not know where the lids are. At a young age, I realized the value of my time, and I began cutting back on a few things. I cut back on video games. I cut back on watching television. I had a girlfriend at the time who wasn't really supportive, so I broke things off with her. I was sad for a week or two, but after those 2 weeks, I was like, whoa, look at all of this money I'm saving. This is unbelievable. And look at all this time I have. What am I gonna do? I'm gonna start some more businesses. So more than anything, I wanted to build a strong foundation for my life before I took on the responsibilities of another human's emotions. And that's a really big responsibility to take on, especially when you both don't know what the heck you wanna do. So I stayed single for a really long time, and I just worked hard and tried to figure out what I was passionate about before taking that other step on. And then, like I said, partying. The amount of money that I've saved my entire life from not going out on Thursdays, Fridays, Saturdays, recouping Sundays, and half of Mondays, that's 5 days a week my entire life that I've been able to operate a little bit quicker and have a little bit more time to try out other businesses. And even though I failed at many of them, I was able to fail fast, and every failure taught me something new and eventually got me to this Johnny Cupcakes t-shirt brand where I get to work with my family every single day. Failing is good. You learn something, and you know, a lot of people don't even start their ideas because they're afraid of failing and they get haunted with the what ifs. What if my family doesn't approve? What if this doesn't work out? I fail every single day. I still fail every single day. And sometimes it's not the greatest, but you learn great things. So when you go back to the drawing board, you can have an idea that is just as powerful as the idea from before. So even though I don't go to parties or I don't party, I will go out and I'll bring Orajel with me when I go to parties. Now, Orajel is the stuff that makes your mouth numb when you have a cavity. It's almost like a gel format of Novocaine. When my friends aren't looking, I'll put this on the rims of their drinks, and by the time they go hit on a cute guy or girl, they start drooling down their face because they are allergic to the, you know, their mouth becomes numb. So even though I don't party, even though I've never drank alcohol before, I find ways every single day to involve humor in life inside and outside of work. Life is very short, and there's a lot of people out there. Raise your hand if you know someone who's not happy unless they have something to complain about. Anybody? If you're not raising your hand, you are that person, by the way. You're like, I'm too good to raise my hand. I'm just kidding. Kind of not really. But seriously, though, it's life is really short. You just have to make a couple changes in your life. And they might not be easy. But if you know what you don't like, then that's great. You know what you don't want to do, and you can make those changes. But you're the only person that can do that. So I kept failing. I kept making those changes. I started hanging out with people that were more passionate and had more creativity and more ambition than some of my other friends. I still love my other friends, but I wanted to surround myself with creative people that would also push me to think a little bit differently. I went to school for a little bit. I ended up taking a break. My parents were really supportive. They said, it's not going anywhere. We want you to figure out what you're passionate about. But while I was at school, I did learn to take less classes so that I could focus on the ones that I really liked. School is not a race. There's no point to it if you're trying to remember all this stuff just to pass and then you forget everything. Take your time. You don't have to graduate when your friends do, as long as you can enjoy and remember what you are learning. So when I did take that break, and I guess I'm still on that break a little bit, I bought a pin-making machine off of eBay. It makes pins, buttons, badges. I bought this for about $130. To this day, it's made me hundreds of thousands of dollars just making arts and crafts and watching the Cartoon Network and making time to resell these pins at concerts. At one point, I had these sold through all the Newbury Comics locations throughout New England. I teamed up with a friend of mine. He was better at design. He had a better printer. And our business doubled, tripled, quadrupled. It was going great until my friend got a girlfriend. And all of a sudden, my friend was not passionate anymore about doing arts and crafts with me on the weekend in a dark room. He would rather hang out with a really cute girl. I don't know why, but that's what happened. And I realized, you know what? Even though this business failed, I'm going to keep positive. And if I start a business again, I'm going to do it by myself. Because I don't want to jeopardize a friendship. Money makes people funny. And I want to hold myself accountable. Whether I fail or succeed, I want to hold myself accountable. So I kept positive. Had to come up with another business idea. While my friends were hanging out with cute girls at parties, I was hanging out with cute old ladies at Joanne Fabrics. I would go up and down this fleece fabric aisle looking for fleece fabric that was on sale for $3. I would get a yard of fabric for $3. I'd then get a pizza cutter. I'd cut it in three strips, and for $3, I could make three scarves that I would then resell for $30 each, making $90, an $87 profit anytime I spent $3. This was going great. You don't even have to know how to sew to make these scarves. If you can cut pizza, and if you can talk to people and make eye contact and leave your home and go to craft fairs and concerts and just leave your social circle to grow your brand, you can do some pretty cool things. This was great. I had these scarves sold through all throughout New England. They were sold through Newbury Comics. They were sold in some like pharmacies. I went to craft fairs. This was going great until summer came around and nobody wanted to buy these anymore. So I had to come up with another business. I also needed health insurance, so I had to get a full-time job. I got a job at Newbury Comics in Braintree, Massachusetts, selling records. And it was great. I love my job. I'd probably still be there if I didn't think of this idea because I just enjoyed the people I worked with, and it didn't feel like work. I laughed every single day. And whether you work for yourself or for another company, if you can go home smiling, laughing every day, It affects your health, it affects how you treat other people, and it's your life. It's where you spend most of your time, at work. It should be a good place. So this was the car I used to drive. There's nothing wrong with it. It got me from point A to point B, and it inspired me every single day to work just a little bit harder to try to get some more ideas off the ground. While working at Newbury Comics, since my name is Johnny, my goofy coworkers would call me Johnny Appleseed. If I was late for work, they'd call me Johnny Come Lately. Johnny Cupcakes came out of nowhere, and I thought it was pretty funny. So while getting t-shirts made for the hardcore metal band that I was in at the time, I was in a band called On Broken Wings, I thought I'd make a few t-shirts that said Johnny Cupcakes to advertise a bakery that didn't even exist. I just wanted to play a joke on people and see what their reaction would be. So I wore that t-shirt to work, and all these slightly miserable customers that never made eye contact with me, they started laughing and saying, "What's Johnny Cupcakes? Is that a bakery? Is that an adult movie store?" And I'm like, no, what are you talking about? It's just a nickname someone gave me. I put it on a shirt, and they're like, "Oh, well, we think that's funny. Where can I buy one of these t-shirts?" Enough people asked me that it almost became annoying, and I was like, okay, interesting. So I love playing tricks on people, and I like to make people happy, so this is working out pretty good. Maybe I should make more of these t-shirts. So with the money I was saving from not partying, and with the money that I was making off of the few t-shirts that I sold, or from my other businesses, I would just put them back into these shirts. If I sold 12 t-shirts, I would then make 24 t-shirts. If I sold 24 t-shirts, I'd make 28. And then I started making tote bags, and hooded sweatshirts, and hats, and the brand slowly but surely grew. The more I put in, the more I got out of it, and it was great. I'd go to concerts, I'd go to craft fairs, I would sell shirts in the parking lot of Newbury Comics because people, strangers, would go up to me and say, "Psst, are you that cupcake guy? Where can I get one of those t-shirts?" And I'm like, "What do you need? I'll meet you in the parking lot at 3:00. And I would go sell t-shirts out of the back of my rusty, beat-up Toyota Camry, and this was great. And when I made money, I would just save it and put it back into the business. I would always reinvest it back into myself. Even if the brand was not taken off super quick, I still wanted to put it back into the brand, and that's what I've done since day one. These are some t-shirts just to give you an idea of what we do. We poke fun at pop culture, replacing popular icons with cupcakes. This guy's pooping out cupcakes. Now we remix, we use the different sports seasons to remix the brand every year, every season. We come out with our sports themed shirts. We did a Got Cupcake shirt instead of Got Milk, but it looked a little weird, so we didn't do it. It looked like mashed potatoes. So we did Make Cupcakes Not War, Chubby Chef Slam Dunking a Cupcake. And instead of a basketball, we even packaged these in little tiny sneaker boxes to go along with the experience. Easy's hat says Cupcakes instead of Compton. We made those hats. They sold pretty well. Now, I've met more than 2,000 people around the world that have Johnny Cupcakes tattoos. I've seen my logo tattooed on people's backs, necks, faces. I've seen tattoos in places that I wish I did not see. At first, I thought it was a little strange, but after meeting a lot of these customers, I realized that many people have been inspired to start their own brand, to live a healthier lifestyle, and some people just love the logo. So to give you an idea of why we have that brand loyalty, I've even seen people camp out sleeping on Newbury Street in front of our store up to 2 weeks, like a homeless person sleeping, waiting for the special edition t-shirts to drop. What we do that's a little bit different is we try to create an experience around everything. Now, I meet people every day that start t-shirt brands. T-shirts have been around forever, so how do we stay relevant? We've been in business for more than 15 years now. It's still an independent, family-run brand. I never took any business classes. I never took any design classes. I never took any marketing classes. If I could go back in time, I totally would have utilized all of those resources so that I could get ahead a little bit more quicker, but I just learned from trying things out and from failing. So if I could do this with something as weird as cupcakes on t-shirts, there is no reason whatsoever why you cannot do this with anything, especially with all these resources in this room right now. It takes time, you have to be positive, you have to be okay with failing, and you just have to make time for it. So we will release a t-shirt to give you an example. We did a breakfast-themed t-shirt, and we sold this during breakfast hours. Once it hit noon or 1 o'clock, we would not sell this t-shirt anymore. Even if you drove from New York City to Boston, I'm not gonna sell this shirt to you because it's not breakfast time. We've definitely lost a few customers by doing this because they don't think it's funny when they show up to buy the t-shirt. However, anytime they have breakfast for the rest of their lives, they're gonna talk about this brand and share that moment when that jerk-faced Johnny Cupcakes wouldn't sell them a shirt because it wasn't breakfast time. Now, the people who did get the shirt around breakfast time, they love it. Anytime they have breakfast, they share that memory. Now, we took a shirt that we usually sell for $30 to $36. We were able to sell it for $40 to $50. We sold out of them within 24 hours, and customers waited in line. We even gave out real breakfast with every t-shirt purchase to go along with the theme of the release. This is a shirt that's coming out soon. We're gonna do a Where's Johnny t-shirt. We're not even gonna sell it. It's gonna be so exclusive, the only way to get this t-shirt is to find me, to physically find me when I post on social media. Hey, it's Johnny, I'm at this sketchy gas station. The first 7 people to find me get this free t-shirt. And everyone's gonna be like, that's weird, but what if it's true? Screw it, I have nothing else to do. Let's go see if this is real. If you find me and wear that t-shirt, you're gonna share that story forever. You just chased some little dude who owns a t-shirt brand into a dark bathroom at this gas station in a really bad town, and you got the t-shirt. And that's a fun story. Now, by me giving out for free, I'm not losing money because I'm providing a memory that's gonna act as advertising and marketing anytime someone wears their t-shirts. They're almost memories. It's like memories through apparel. This is, and I'd post about that through my Johnny Cupcakes Snapchat or my Instagram or my Johnny Cupcakes YouTube channel, so keep an eye out. I might be going to a scary gas station near you or a theater near you. Oftentimes we'll do corporate gifting. Companies will approach us and it's like they're giving a $30 bonus to all of their employees. But instead, they purchase shirts from us at $30 each. It's a little bit lower than what we usually sell them for, but we'll actually work with them and design a special edition t-shirt for the company they work with or for their school or for their business. It will provide packaging, and sometimes we'll even use our social media channels to post about this. So everyone gets excited. All the employees get this fun little bonus shirt as like a quarterly gift. This is something that we did with Suffolk University. And this is another shirt we did with Kerasilk for their hair products. It's someone washing their hair with frosting. We've done other collaborations, and I'm just showing you a few things we've done to remix the brand to help us stay relevant in a world full of distractions. We worked with Marilyn Monroe's estate, and we've replaced her beauty mark with a little teeny tiny cupcake. It's actually kind of gross, but it makes people laugh, and we sold a bunch of t-shirts. We've done collaborations with Warner Brothers, with Looney Tunes, with bicycle cards. Sanrio approached us a few years back and we did a project for Hello Kitty. They posted this on their Facebook fan page that had over 10 million fans at the time. Our website nearly crashed and we generated $250,000 in sales within 24 hours with zero traditional advertising. This was unbelievable. Our website nearly crashed. My mom, who's now the CFO of my company, did not know what was going on. She thought it was fake, but it was real. It was the best thing that happened. We realized that collaborations are amazing. And with the financial success set aside, the best thing that comes out of a collaboration is the cross-pollination, other people's customers and fans learning about what you do and vice versa. Because those people could be brand ambassadors for the rest of your life if you play your cards right. We realized this was so successful that we decided to do it again. We decided to do it with the Ninja Turtles. We didn't really do it with the Ninja Turtles, that would be really weird, but we collaborated with the Ninja Turtles and we made these special edition t-shirts. Viacom approached us, who owns Nickelodeon and owns Ninja Turtles, and they wanted us to create some special edition t-shirts to build up hype for the new Ninja Turtles movie. The person who called me was from the licensing department and his name was Donatello, and I was like, hello, are you serious? Is this a prank call? Who is this? And there was a little Italian man that wanted to make some shirts with us, so we did. We put our Johnny Cupcakes twist on everything. Now, we had to realize that everything's been done before. Now, even though we have some cool designs, it's more than that. And you can never get too comfortable. So anytime you come out with a project, a product, an idea, you have to keep pushing yourself further until you become exhausted. Because once you become too comfortable, you stop reinventing yourself and people start learning about other brands and they stop supporting you. So why is somebody really going to leave their home on a Saturday? Why would they put their phone down? More importantly, if someone's going to go out to a Johnny Cupcakes event and wait in line on the weekend to spend money, how are they going to convince their roommate or their significant other to go wait with them? So a few things you can do to throw a successful event. Food always works. Anytime you give out free food, people don't even care what's going on. There's going to be snacks. So they go and they have an open mind. Entertainment, music, gift bags, surprises. We had the Ninja Turtles themselves go out and surprise people at our pop-up shop that we had for 4 years on Carnaby Street in London. We opened it up for the Olympics and we stayed there for a little bit longer. This was great. Our customers were so excited that some of them went to the bathroom in their pants. Just kidding. Kind of not really. But I realized that in every workforce, creative thinking must be applied. Whether that's through stories and sales, marketing and advertising, product development, leadership and education, how to keep students engaged in school, customer experience and social media. So we try to incorporate all those things into every aspect of the brand. We did a project with G-Shock watches recently, and it was very, very successful. We were very surprised to hear that we beat the rapper Eminem's sales. We beat his 3-week sales in a few hours, and they had the number one selling, Eminem had the number one selling collaboration watch. But by teamwork and thinking outside of the box, and trying things out a little bit differently and building that brand loyalty, we were able to accomplish something really big by still staying really small. We're still a family-run brand, no investors, with no education on marketing or any of the things we're doing. We just try until things work out. I'm probably gonna screw up a whole bunch of times, but that one time when it works out, it's a really good feeling. It's kind of like gambling, but not really, but really. So that was great. We also were able to use G-Shock's store, Casio's store in Soho. They gave it to us for 4 days, and we had a Johnny Cupcakes pop-up shop for free in the middle of Soho, New York City, which was really great. We were able to generate some extra sales and meet some new customers that are now lifelong brand ambassadors. We've done projects with Nickelodeon, and the last example I want to show you is something we did with The Simpsons. This was 2 years in the making for The Simpsons' big anniversary. Fox approached us. They wanted us to remix their brand, and so we did. We packaged shirts in giant cupcakes boxes. Each T-shirt came with other products. Homer's came with socks and a watch. Krusty's came with a bow tie and a hat. Bart's came with a wallet and a pair of glasses. So what else can we do to get people excited? Cool, The Simpsons, that's great. That really does help. Because someone might not know or care about Johnny Cupcakes, but when they're walking by our pop-up shop on Martha's Vineyard in the summer in Oak Bluffs, or when they're walking by our Newbury Street shop in Boston, and they see The Simpsons in the window, even though they don't know or might not care about the Johnny Cupcakes brand, when we collaborate with another company, it could potentially connect with another person's childhood and act as a gateway drug into our brand. Kind of like when a band covers a song and you go out and you buy that musician's album and you start learning about them because of that cover song. So what else can we do to get people out, to get people to convince their significant others to wait in line to spend money to buy T-shirts? Well, we gave out Duff Energy drinks to everybody that came out that day in Los Angeles at our Johnny Cupcake shop in Hollywood. We gave out real cupcakes, which we don't normally have. We're a T-shirt brand with retail stores that look and smell like bakeries with T-shirts displayed in refrigerators. So when we do sell real cupcakes, it really throws people off because we have many people who hate us for not selling real food. Check all the reviews on the food websites. We had Homer Simpson come out and strangle people that were waiting in line for T-shirts. So if you're driving by and you don't know about Johnny Cupcakes and you see a 9-8 foot tall Homer Simpson choking people, you're probably gonna pull over and Snapchat that or take a photo for Instagram, and then you're gonna tag it at the Johnny Cupcakes location, and all of a sudden, 400 of your friends know about Johnny Cupcakes, so they're asking about Johnny Cupcakes, and they rush to the store to meet the Simpson. They might leave with a T-shirt, and it helps the brand grow. My mother even dressed up like Marge Simpson when she greeted all the customers that day. So these little things were great. People thrive off of new experiences. It's true, people thrive off of new experiences, so much so that they are sometimes willing to camp out for days.
Yeah!
So many of those people camped out for days. They got their t-shirts. They sold out in minutes. It was a really great, successful event. My concept is strange, but strange is good. Strange is important. It sets you apart from the rest. You may or may not care about the band Kiss, but we all know about them. They dress up like clowns and perform rock and roll. There's Mario Brothers. It's a really funny concept. It's a plumber who shoots fire out of his nose and or mouth. We still don't know. But we do know he is definitely looking for a princess inside of a sewer. Although it's a really strange concept, it's the most recognized video game franchise in the world. Speaking of sewers, there's the Ninja Turtles. They eat pizza in a sewer where poo-poo floats by. They're still teenagers for some reason, and it works, and it's weird, but we all know about it. Rainforest Cafe, whether or not you appreciate the food there, we all know about it because a child cannot walk past this establishment without dragging his or her parents inside because you're eating food inside of a rainforest. So anytime you start a business, a product, or a project, always ask yourself, what are 12-plus things that you can do that really, truly separate you from everybody else? People have so many options. Why would a complete stranger want to leave their comfort zone and take a risk on your photography business, on your restaurant, on your hair salon, on your music, on your jewelry, whatever it is that you do? You really want to get people engaged and curious to ask questions and learn about what you do. People have too many options. Why will they take a risk with you? So before that success, I'm touring with the band that I'm in, traveling around. It was the best thing that happened to me. Even if you take a sketchy bus that might catch on fire from Boston to New York City just for the day, it's really good because it helps you think outside of the box. You get inspiration. When you come back home, you're all jazzed up and you have new ideas to build your life personally and professionally. Traveling's been the best thing for me. I sold t-shirts out of my rusty suitcase. They were wrinkled up. They smelled like gas and fast food. But I was selling out of these shirts left and right. Anytime I wore a t-shirt, other bands that my band would tour with would ask about that and say, what's Johnny Cupcakes? Where can I get one of those shirts? Other bands would wear these t-shirts. Those bands would travel around the world. They'd get photographed in magazines. All of a sudden, Johnny Cupcakes is getting full-page ads in magazines for free because other people are wearing the t-shirts. Word of mouth spread like wildfire, which I actually said once during a lecture I gave in California, and everybody became silent. So word of mouth spread like peanut butter, and all these people learned about the Johnny Cupcakes brand, and I decided to go to my first trade show. There's a trade show out there for everything in the world. I left the band because I wanted to put 100% into Johnny Cupcakes. If I try to do a million different things, and if I do not stay focused, I am going to half-step a million different things, and I need to focus on one thing at a time. So that was great. I got my t-shirt sold in stores in Italy, Japan, Australia, all over the world. It was really fun, really successful. But then I decided I wanted to go back home and work on my own website. Because if I can curate a customer's experience, that's great. If I try to sell my shirts in stores all over the world and all of a sudden they stop buying shirts and I just hired a bunch of new employees, I'm in big trouble. So I wanted to rely on myself and get my online shop up. But the best thing I took away from that trade show was the high-fiving, the networking, meeting new people, learning from other people's success and other people's failures, which is why a program like this and an event like this is very important. So a quick round of applause for everyone who set this up. And for you guys, for making time to learn and to figure out ways that you can improve your lives. So the best thing I took away from that trade show was the high-fiving, networking, learning from other people's success and other people's failures. I went back home. Oh, and I like to say, meet strangers unless they drive a white van. It's really important to meet new people, leave your social circle. Everyone in here has a story. Everybody in this room has a skill set, and you will never know unless you talk to each other. So please network after this event. Moving forward, my parents' house was filled with boxes of t-shirts. You had to play Tetris to get to the bathroom, the refrigerator. All of a sudden, I had to open up the attic and build my own little warehouse in the attic. And even though it was 110 degrees up there and I was getting scoliosis from bending over so much and splinters, I was so excited that people from places I had never been to were purchasing t-shirts from our website. It was incredible. This was going great. When people buy things online, I noticed that they started spending a little bit more than they do in person. I don't know about you, but raise your hand if you've ever purchased an extra product online just because you told yourself, hey, I'm already paying for shipping. I might as well buy a few more things. Do you know how insane that is? That's like a gambler's way of thinking. Hey, to take advantage of this $5 shipping fee, I'm going to spend another $40 and really stick it to them. And it's like, all right. Well, I'm not complaining. The average Johnny Cupcakes customer orders an average of 3 products at our website, and it's been great. When people buy things online, they spend a little bit more money. They're not seeing cash leave their hands. They're typing in their PayPal or credit card, debit card numbers, and our website has grown a lot. Also, many people have found out about the Johnny Cupcakes brand just through searching for cupcake recipes on Google, which is pretty weird. At one point, we had a section of our online form when you're checking out. It asked customers where they heard about me from, so I got to learn about how they heard about the brand. Most of it's been through a friend. In the past 15 years, I've spent little to no money on traditional advertising. It's mostly been through word of mouth. I've always taken my advertising budget and I've put it into building unique experiences around the products, the events, the retail environment, and by doing that, the customers do the advertising for us. So everything was going great, but some people got t-shirts in the mail that smelled like cigarette smoke, had cat hair on them, and all of a sudden people were upset. I learned about packaging the hard way. Packaging could make or break an experience and a business decision. Raise your hand if you've ever saved your sneaker boxes. Anybody? All right. A lot of people go to McDonald's for the toys, the Happy Meal. Raise your hand if you've ever saved packaging from the Apple Store just because it opens in 14 different weird ways. You're like, that's a cool box, can't throw it out. All right, raise your hand if you know anybody that saves the sticker on their baseball or basketball caps that announces what size head they have. It's a pretty strange concept if you think about it. Imagine if we flipped our pants inside out to show people our waist size. But people do this because this little shiny bit of packaging makes that sweaty, dirty hat seem a little bit more brand new than it actually is on the inside. Packaging goes a long way. A lot of children go to Build-A-Bear, not even for the bears. They just want that cardboard dollhouse that they can color on that the bear gets packaged in. It goes a long way, and it could be used in multiple different ways, especially if it gets featured on different packaging blogs. I like to say good packaging does not get thrown away, and it acts as a miniature billboard. We've packaged earrings and food containers with flavors on them and even nutrition facts on the back to go along with the branding of the Johnny Cupcakes DNA. We package all of our t-shirts and pastry boxes. I don't know if we brought any today. Did we bring any pastry boxes today? We didn't bring any today, but we're going to do a pop-up shop after. Even if you don't buy anything, you should come and at least check out some of the shirts that we brought. It might give you some inspiration for your brand. We once packaged our shirts in ice cream containers that we sold out of ice cream trucks that we rented in New York City, Santa Monica, San Francisco, and Los Angeles. Not only do we sell ice cream-themed t-shirt designs out of ice cream trucks and in ice cream containers, but we gave out free ice cream with every t-shirt purchase. And to make it really fun, we didn't tell our customers where we were going to be until the night before. So our customers had to chase us like little kids chasing an ice cream truck. We package our t-shirts in oversized containers and even giant push-up pops with rolled-up t-shirts inside of them. You pull the handle off, makes a little funny noise. Now, by us taking our $30 to $37 t-shirt, $36 t-shirt, and putting this cool packaging on it, cool branding out of an ice cream truck, we sold these for between $60 and $75, and we sold out of them at every single stop. If you search Johnny Cupcakes on eBay, you'll find some of these t-shirts selling for around $300. A little packaging goes a long way. We've packaged frosting shirts, frosting containers with fake frosting drips that smell like frosting, Chinese food themed shirts, in-to-go packaging, oversized. We didn't print on existing boxes. We made these from scratch because of how obsessed we are with that experience. We've done Halloween themed shirts around Halloween with fake movie titles. We even went as far as making movie trailers that we put on our Johnny Cupcakes YouTube channel. We set our stores up like haunted houses. Our employees got to dress up like zombies. And we packaged the Halloween movie-themed t-shirts inside VHS tapes to give you a little collectible. Again, we were able to price this shirt that usually goes for $30-something dollars to more than $50, and we sold out of them at every event that we did. At some of our Halloween events, I've even gone as far as renting out an actual hearse and a coffin from a creepy gentleman on Craigslist who owns those things for $220. Now, for me to spend $220 on a coffin and a hearse that I was going to use just for 1 hour, it was more valuable than spending $30,000, $20,000, or even $1,000 on a full-page advertisement. Because if you see a hearse and a coffin on Newbury Street in Boston in front of a cupcake store that doesn't sell cupcakes, you're going to stay there and you're going to ask questions. And every single one of our customers is going to act as a brand ambassador and share the Johnny Cupcake story with you. We had almost everybody on that street stop that day taking photos. The social media was really, really high, the engagement levels, and it was wonderful. So that was fun, and we rebranded the hearse to say Johnny Cupcakes, the Undertaker Baker, and it was a blast. So you get the idea. Packaging is important. It adds to that experience. We've done burger shirts, burger packaging. When we ship out shirts, sometimes they come in cool packaging. Sometimes they don't. Sometimes we mix it up. Sometimes we give out vintage trading cards. You might get a vintage Ghostbusters, Ninja Turtles, New Kids on the Block, or Power Rangers trading card. There's no rhyme or reason to it. It just is to make you happy or give you something to talk about. Sometimes we'll put a pack of batteries in someone's order. Sometimes we'll put a chocolate bar, a $20 bill, or a doll's head. The more strange it is, the more someone is going to talk about the brand. Now I just have to figure out what to do with all of the bodies. So we ship out shirts every day all over the world. My number one goal in life and in business is to make sure that I can make other people feel like it's their birthday anytime I meet them. And that is what satisfies me. Maybe I have a weird fascination with wanting to be some version of Santa Claus, or I really want to be a parent really bad, but I haven't had kids yet. But this is just something that I really enjoy doing, is keeping people guessing, giving people that surprise. That feeling you used to get when you would buy cereal and there was a prize in the box, and now you have to type in a 20 case-sensitive digit online, and other people are making money off their advertisement online because of this code you're typing in, and there's no more of that enjoyment. Getting that free soda underneath the cap, and I just read that Cracker Jack is doing away with their prizes. They're not putting random prizes in anymore, and that made me cry. I have a tear in my eye right now, seriously. I am not right in the head right now. So anyways, we ship out shirts every single day all over the world. Our website is turned into the backbone of the brand, backbone of the business. We consistently release shirts. Every Friday at noon, we have a release. We don't go by a seasonal schedule like most brands. We release t-shirts every Friday, every week throughout the entire year. Every Friday at noon on our website. Now, sometimes I'll take a break from work and I'll write a handwritten note on someone's package, and it goes a really long way. This is something you can do for free. Handwritten notes go a long way. Even if you don't have a brand, thank your teacher, thank your friend, thank your family, your significant other. It's way better than a text message or an email. A few people have said things when they got their package in the mail. This person said, I received this gem in the mail today and realized that Johnny Cupcakes personally saw my package. This little act of kindness definitely made my day. I've fully supported the Johnny Cupcakes brand for the past 8 years and will forever continue to support such an amazing brand. Thank you so much, Johnny. All I did was write thank you, and this took me 2 seconds, and this person's telling me they're gonna buy shirts for the rest of their life. This wasn't a marketing idea. I'm just very thankful that people care about these t-shirts, so I wrote a thank you message. A handwritten note goes a long way, especially in this digital day and age. This person said, I just peed myself, hashtag legit, hashtag no judgment. So this is something you can do immediately, and it's free. It's free. So we ship out shirts all over the world. Some of our older shirts had oven mitt tags in them. You can't really bake with them, but it's pretty fun. Some shirts have secret messages inside. I can't show you because it's a secret. We have developed rolling pin packaging with real wooden handles that are hollowed out on the inside. It's a pretty cool idea. You pull your shirt out from inside of the rolling pin. It's a great idea until you realize that you do not use rolling pins when you make cupcakes. So we are putting this idea on hold temporarily. This is our mascot. We call him Big Kid. He's a really cute little mascot. I think every brand should have a mascot. It's very rememberable. It's very memorable, and it goes great with merchandising. When I went out to Japan to give a few lectures at some of the universities out there, I realized there was a mascot for every single thing in Japan. I even bought a toy at a toy shop, but when I went through security, I was informed that the toy was a mascot for some special ointment that I should not be proud of. But I still kept the toy. This is the packaging. We even put a little scale on top of it. I thought it was pretty fun. Now, real quick, I wanted to get into your business card, your website, your resume. These are all extensions of your personality. Here's a wooden business card. If I had to choose between 200 carpenters to work on my home and the person with the least experience had the coolest business card, I would probably interview them first, because it shows me that that person put that much time, energy, creativity, thought, and heart into something as small as their business card. This may have cost this gentleman a couple dollars per business card, but if they get a $20,000 deal on working on someone's home, that $2 is worth it for that business card. Here's a clear business card. Here's a miniature one. This one's cool if you're starting a clothing line. And this one really stands out. My first business card was a Home Alone 2 Lost in New York trading card. I just wrote my name and number on the back, and it was pretty memorable. You can have fun with your business card. It's an extension of your personality. If you're a creative person, you should do something creative. Before all that success, I had to move out of my parents' house. I still live there. I love my parents. I still live there at the time. But I moved my operations down the street. There was a space that was available for rent for $700 a month, and I had to get away from the cigarettes, smoke, the cat hair, and the sawdust. I needed my own space. This was zoned commercially, so we hosted the community events. We built a community over time, and often when I travel, I'll post on my social media, hey, it's Johnny Cupcakes. I'm in San Francisco. If you meet me at this pizza shop at 3 o'clock and you wear your Johnny Cupcake shirt, I'm going to treat you to lunch. I'll think maybe 12 people will show up, and 400 people will show up at the pizza shop, all with Johnny Cupcakes t-shirts. We had to take all of these customers and bring them from Blondie's Pizza in San Francisco to Union Square, and I just spent the day feeding people hot slices of pizza. Some people got cold slices because we had to move the pizza. But this is cheaper than advertising, and it's fun. And I don't have many friends in San Francisco, so why not hang out with my customers? We've done this with pizza, with ice cream, with dodgeball. There's a lot of ways to engage with your customers and to be more than just a brand. So I try to be the Willy Wonka of t-shirts. I've met over 2,000 people with Johnny Cupcakes logos. This girl has one on her neck. I think it's cool, but her dad probably hates me. This guy has one on his leg. Even Travie McCoy of Gym Class Heroes got a giant Johnny Cupcakes tattoo on his leg. This guy got one on his neck. I was going to give a lecture in Denver, Colorado. Out of all the people I sat next to, this one person recognized my t-shirt. And he said, oh, I love Johnny Cupcakes. I love your t-shirt. Check out this tattoo I just got. And I said, oh, that's cool. So, and that was it. So, wrapping things up, the turning point of my brand is when I took a really big risk. 10 years ago, I opened up a shop on Newbury Street, and it was scary. I went from spending $700 a month on rent in my hometown to spending around $8,000 a month on rent in a space that I had no idea what was going to happen. I did look at my online sales, and I was like, all right, there's a lot of people that purchase our shirts in New England. Maybe some of them will come to our shop. I did sit on the doorstep of this property for a few days, and I counted the people that walked by, and I said, all right, if I can trick half of these people into thinking I sell food, and half of those people buy a t-shirt, but 100% of those people leave with an experience and something to talk about, I think we can make this work. Let's give it a try. So gave it a try. Took that risk. It was really scary, but it was great. There's my dad and I. I was really happy to work with my dad. I think the reason why I don't drink alcohol is because my dad was an alcoholic growing up, and I never would have thought he would have quit drinking, but he's been sober for more than a decade, and it's like I have a brand new dad, and it's unbelievable. I'm very proud of him. So by having a family-run business, I've been able to involve my family in a lot of these activities, and it's really been great. So I was really excited to work with my dad and open up this store on Newbury Street. If you look really, really closely at this photo, I look a little too excited. I just had to show you this because I'm a really short person, so anytime I wear pants, I get this weird situation going and I have to cuff my pants like 1,000 times. But anyways, that opening day was great. It was very successful. We had 400 plus people waiting in line forever. The line wrapped up and down Newbury Street. It wasn't even a single file line, and it was with no traditional advertising. The line was as big as the line on Boylston Street to get into the new Apple store. It was unbelievable. Even people that knew nothing about the brand were jumping in line. Oh, cupcakes. I want to order some cupcakes. They're waiting in line for hours. On the phone, hey, I'm at Johnny Cupcakes. How many red velvet cupcakes? Okay, cool. I'll pick those up. Now, all of my existing customers that are waiting in line for t-shirts, they're not saying a thing because they're so excited to see the reaction on these people's faces when they get in the store and 3 or 4 hours later and a few parking tickets later. So when they get in the store, it's not a pretty sight. Where are the cupcakes? Are they in the back? What's going on? Is this a joke? And I'm like, no, my name's Johnny. I make sure it's the cupcakes on them. And this guy was not happy. He said, good luck. You're going to need it. I'd like to see this place last more than a month. Well, it's our 10-year anniversary in a couple weeks, and it's exciting. And sometimes you have to take that negativity from other people and turn it into motivation to prove those suckers wrong. And that's really what you have to do. And if you hang out with negative people, you have to slowly shift away to more positive people because I promise you, it will affect how you feel every single day. And in business, those negative people are poison to a company, to a team. So you got to be positive. And if you are a negative person, hey, life isn't so bad. Go read a comic book, eat an ice cream sundae. It's all good. Things could be worse. Just turn on the news every day, and you should feel very thankful about your life. So this was great. People jumping in line, confused. People from Berklee School of Music, stoned out of their minds. Whoa, Johnny Cupcakes. I'm going to get the munchies. I'm going to get a cupcake. And they get up the stairs 10 hours later, and they're like, whoa, Johnny Cupcakes, more like Johnny Beepcakes. And I'm like, all right, you know, what should I do? So what I did a couple years ago is on April Fool's Day, we sold cupcakes, and we hid all of our T-shirts. We really blew people's minds. So I might open up a store next door called Johnny's T-shirts that only sells cupcakes just to mess with people. But seriously, whether people leave upset or happy, they all leave with a story to tell, and they promote the brand more than any advertising could, and it's been great. We are, on our 10-year anniversary on the 14th of May, we are going to start selling donuts, not cupcakes. Who wants cupcakes? We're going to do donuts. So we're forming a partnership with Union Square Donuts in Somerville, Massachusetts, and they're making us these special edition donuts that we're going to sell every day, almost as a secret, but we're going to keep them by the cash register. And we're also going to have our limited edition Boston-themed T-shirt designs that you can only get if you physically go to the shop. We try to do that with our website and with our store, so it gives people a reason to travel and to collect different shirts, and it really helps build the brand and the brand loyalty. So opening that shop, even kids that used to make fun of me were in line with money. If I could go back in time, I would have put itching powder inside of their T-shirts. This was great. I could have saved a tremendous amount of money if I went to IKEA and purchased inexpensive displays. I love IKEA. I love the Swedish meatballs. But if I did that, my retail store would look like every other shop on Newbury Street. So it's in my best interest to open up a store that's very, truly unique, even if I have to go broke doing it and buying commercial baking equipment just to display T-shirts in. I even hide vanilla-scented car fresheners. So when you walk into our Johnny Cupcake shop in Boston, you smell frosting. I convinced my friend Boris. He was like, oh, how'd you do that? That's really cool. I said, oh, well, I mixed vanilla frosting with white paint. And he's like, oh, really? I was like, yeah, you know, if you lick this part of the wall, you'll be able to taste it. You'll be able to taste it just a little bit. So he licked this part of the wall. He's like, I don't really taste anything. I smell it, but I don't taste it. I was like, oh, actually, I'm sorry, dude. I think it's on this part of the wall. So he went over here. So I still don't taste it. And then I tricked him one more time, and he realized I was joking with him. So if I could go back in time, I probably should have put Orajel all over the wall so his mouth would go numb. So like I say, I try to involve humor in my life every single day. After all, I trick hungry people for a living. And when you do that, it makes life not so bad after all. I think it's so important, no matter what field of business you're in. So that's the shop. Looks like a bakery, smells like a bakery, and it's a really fun time. If you ever have a chance to visit on Newbury Street, just hang out and watch people's reactions. You'll have a very fun comedy show for free. So after that opening, we made around 3 months' rent in one day. Off of selling T-shirts in a bakery that doesn't sell food. And I was able to hire my mom full-time after that. She quit her job in the city that once inspired me to be an entrepreneur so I could spend more time with my family someday. And shortly after, I hired my dad to build out the shops. I hired my sister when she graduated from business school because she learned a lot of skill sets that I knew nothing about. And I don't have the time, energy, patience, or I just can't sit still, so I don't know that I'm going to, I want to focus on what I'm good at. And you can always delegate tasks, but you want to focus on what you're best at, and that's what you should be focusing on. So that's what I did. I'm an idea person. Built a positive team over time. It's not just me. I wouldn't be here without these amazing people, including Marvin over here, who just joined the team. Round of applause for Marvin. Marvin is helping with all our special projects. Any companies, schools that want to do collaboration shirts with us for corporate gifting, he handles all that. And sometimes he goes on the road with me and runs all the pop-up shops and just a little bit of everything. And he's also my ping pong partner. We love ping pong. If you ever want to challenge, if there's a ping pong table here, we will play ping pong with you, maybe for a free shirt if we can get a ping pong table in here. So, and some deodorant too. So, yeah, I wouldn't be here without all these people. It's not just me. We all work together to involve the bigger picture. I focus on what I'm good at, and that's coming up with wild ideas, taking risks, and keeping positive, even when poo-poo hits the fan. This is a funny image someone posted on the internet. Johnny Cupcakes, a store called Johnny Cupcakes, doesn't sell cupcakes, I don't get it. This is a similar reaction we see every day. But like I said, the people who don't like us or are confused are the ones who talk about the brand more than anybody, and they do the advertising for you, or for us. So every day, wait, you don't sell cupcakes, it's true, we trick people all the time, we have terrible reviews on food websites, our stores say freshly baked, no sugar, no carbs, no fat. It's true, there's no sugar, no carbs, no fat, there's no cupcakes, it's all fiber, it's all cotton. The only time I feel terrible is when a cute elderly couple walk inside and they have dietary restrictions, so now we're gonna have some special donuts and we'll see what happens. Wrapping things up, I'm gonna share one review with you. And this person gave me 1 star. He said, "This is not cupcake shop. Overpriced t-shirts and not even 1 cupcake. Only when you paid for parking and entered the store, you realize you wasted your time, comma, capital O. On the storefront, they have signs galore, freshly baked, no sugar. Not even 1 sign say they sell cloths. No cupcakes. They think it's clever. Nope. Well, I'll tell you what's clever. I'm going to put this bad review on a t-shirt, and I'm going to sell it for $35. Thank you very much.